Good evening, Thursday, February 21st. It's a work session for the Newburgh City Council. Do I have a motion to go into an executive session?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
You have a motion to come out of executive session?
So moved.
Second.
All right, great. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, so on Monday's council meeting, we're going to have a public hearing regarding the proposed local law, adding chapter 276, article 2, entitled Smoking Outdoors. So that'll be this coming Monday, February 25th. We have two work session presentations this evening. The first one will be from Central Hudson regarding gas main replacement that they will be undertaking in the near future. Gentlemen, if you so wish.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We're here tonight to talk about our 2019 natural gas replacement projects in the city of Newburgh. Tonight here, our team, John Masurgeon, he's our Director of Media Relations, Nathan Jackson, who is an Associate District Director in our Newburgh headquarters. I'm Thomas Palmer, Superintendent of Gas Transmission and Distribution, overseeing our contractor forces. Brian Sweeney, who is our project foreman for the projects, was not able to make it this evening. So I'll first get into an overview of our program and then get into the specifics for this year's projects. The replacement of leak-prone natural gas mains and services is on an accelerated basis started 3 years prior. And you may ask, what is leak-prone pipe? It's cast iron, wrought iron, and bare steel pipes not protected from corrosion. We have an agreement with the Public Service Commission to replace a minimum mileage per year. It's currently 15 miles is our minimum. In the past 2 years, we've replaced 20 and 21 miles, respectively, above the minimum company-wide. And then, like I said, 2019 is our fourth year of the accelerated program. Based on our current inventory of leak-prone pipe, and if we maintain this pipe, the pace that we're replacing it at, we'll be completed with the program in 8 to 10 years. I would like to start off with some benefits to the municipalities in which we're working in. Our top priority is safety. The city, after we replace these old pipes that have been in the ground for sometimes more than 100 years, is much safer, our customers and your residents. There's also a reduction in emergency response demands from city resources with fire and police. And something to illustrate that very effectively is you should have before you the Washington Heights area and our below grade leak history. Prior to the project, there were 80 below grade leaks found and repaired in that area in the 5 years prior to the project. And since the project was completed in that area, there's been zero. So what that means is the residents are safer. The fire department does not have to respond to these leaks and these gas odor calls. And also, when we go and repair the leaks, there's a patch. And for 80 leaks, there could be 100, 110 separate excavations to repair them. And since it's been completely replaced, there's no more digging up of the streets to make these repairs. No disruptions in the middle of the night. And everything is much safer as a result. Some other monetary benefits. There's increased road opening permit revenues. Each and every service that we replace as part of these projects is issued a separate road opening permit, and also increased tax revenues due to the high asset values in the city streets. Many of the pipes that are 100 years old have a very low value. When we install these new pipes in the streets, in the public right-of-way, there's a value associated with that. And with that, we pay taxes based off of that value. So the more pipe that we replace, the higher the value of that pipe. And so we pay additional taxes on that at Central Hudson. And then the last point I'd like to make on this is the opportunity to coordinate with the city to replace the natural gas lines prior to planned paving. We met earlier in this month with the Water Department, DPW, and the Engineer's Office, and we were able to look at the 2019 paving plan, and where we do have leak-prone pipe, we're currently making efforts to replace these pipes prior to your paving, so we don't have to dig them up.
Speaking of that, first of all, is Precision Pipeline going to be continuing?
That's correct.
Okay, so we had the worst experience with these gas line replacements with Precision Pipeline. It was the worst experience the city has ever experienced with these replacement gas lines. And, you know, number one, just the way the roads were all tore up, the complaints that we got from our constituents, myself as a taxpayer and a homeowner here, it was the worst in terms of traffic flow and worse in terms of road destruction and the length of time. It took the whole spring and summer. And then when the work was completed, the roadways were not paved. They were the roadways that were patched up. They were worse than they were before you guys went in there. And then when we talked about this the last time, Mr. Palmer, we talked about it, and it said, with all this new brass underground with these gas lines, who's going to pay for this ultimately? And it's the consumers, which I am a consumer, and everyone's sitting at this table, because, you know, Central Hudson has a utility monopoly. And utility monopolies are legal in America, and you're regulated, as you mentioned earlier, by a public service commission. And so between Precision Pipeline and the roadways being tore up apart, it made it worse, not better. And from my understanding, and Jason Morris can speak to this, being our engineer, superintendent of the engineers department, my understanding, when you guys go in and do these pipeline replacement, you're going to make the roadway better than it was before you went in. And our experience has been worse.
Also, if I can add, when you were up in the Heights, I think it was two summers ago, and you were on my block, which is Bayview, it was not a very good experience. All of the neighbors were really upset. The communication was pretty bad. And it took, I had to get on the phone because they just left my lawn torn up. And, you know, the curb and the sidewalk, not a very good job. No. So how are you gonna do it better this time?
In previous years, we've made a couple different changes, which I'd like to explain. I think the projects in particular that the mayor was speaking about was in 2017, where we undertook a very large size project. I believe the total project length for between the Liberty Street project and the area on Fullerton was 24,000 linear feet, and there was over 400 individual service lines. That was a big undertaking. This year we have a planned project of about 10,000 linear feet with approximately 235 services, and what we'd like to do is start the project first as soon as we can in early March and throw as much resources at it as we can to shorten the amount of time that we're under construction. And what that will allow us to do is to come back and pave immediately following. And we've taken the paving portion, other than the binder course installation, from PPS, and we have a separate paving contractor, BTM, out of Poughkeepsie, that once we're done, we'll come in and pave, do a mill and pave in those areas, many areas up to a lane width. So we've reduced the size of the project that we're undertaking. We're starting it earlier to get it done quicker. And also, we've removed the paving, the final paving portion from them, and we're using a strictly a paving vendor to complete that work.
So, because we spoke before this session, so I did explain that Central Hudson, that we are not friends, that I'm here for the city of Newburgh, right? And so my questions are, I have a couple of questions. If it's mandatory for your company to do this work anyway, as one of the bullets showed, who's going to pick up that cost? Because I do not want that cost to be coming to city of Newburgh residents, especially if it's mandatory for your company. One more. Then my other question is, because some of those streets that you're going to be doing, and I don't want to say them publicly right now, but they're narrow streets. They're one-way streets. The parking already there is a little tough. So what's going to happen with those customers when they have to move? Are they going to be notified well in advance so that they could figure out parking situations for them? And then the other one, back to Mayor Harvey's point, is when you're in those roads, it's very important that you're collaborating with our DPW and with our water department and with everyone else to ensure that once those roads are fixed, that they're put in a better condition than when you found it.
Yes, I think the first point you had regarding the rates, the capital investment projects that we are undertaking are within the ratepayers, our customers and your residents. But the important point to make is that where we're replacing the leak-prone pipe is a minority of our overall customers. And when we replace these projects, those costs are spread across all customers. So the impact to customer bills, on, particularly in the city of Newburgh or any other municipality where we're working, is not completely, they're not burdened with the full cost of that. It's spread out through all customers. So even a gas customer that just hooked up last week is also is that that's within their bill as well.
So Mr. Palmer, so how far and what's the timeline of this gas line replacement? Like, how many years are you going to come before us to continue this process?
The overall program, if we maintain our current pace company-wide in all municipalities, is approximately 8 to 10 years.
Whoa. Mr. Morris, please get to a microphone so we can ask you a few questions, please. So as far as you know, let me ask, before we get to Mr. Morris, last year, this past spring and summer, you said 2017, you did 24,000 square feet of replacement gas lines. Last year, what did you do this past spring and summer?
This past spring and summer, we only did two small projects, one on Concord Street and one on, Chamber Street.
No, you were on Fullerton as well.
No, that was 2017.
Was that 2017? Because I thought they were this Fullerton this summer.
The new transformer?
In the early spring, we were out there completing final paving for the project.
In 2018 on Fullerton.
Correct. That was the final paving, which the project went beyond the original timeline.
Right.
So the final paving took place in the spring. So in reducing the size of the project that we're undertaking this year, we're expecting to finish earlier and then get it paved right away.
Okay.
So you don't run into that situation again.
Okay, so Mr. Morris, my question to you is, what's the process and who's checking up on Central Hudson and Precision Pipeline that they're actually doing the work properly and that they're, is there a plumbing inspector? What?
Yeah, so they operate through a process called the street opening permit when they replace gas mains.
Right.
That's done through the codes department.
Street what?
So there's typically the plumbing inspectors on site to review and inspect backfill and the installation of the pipe.
Okay.
So it's a codes department inspection.
So it's a codes, so it doesn't fall under engineering?
Correct.
So it's a code department inspection, which we now know that the code department is no longer, the fire department is no longer in codes. Is that correct?
No, the fire department doesn't have what to do with it. Typically the street opening permit through codes has been in the purview of the plumbing inspector.
Right.
The plumbing inspector was in more recently in a transitional period.
Right.
We were without, and now we have a kind of a temporary fix and hopefully a longer term solution in the near term. But for street opening permits and compliance with that, that was exclusively the plumbing inspector's
responsibility.
Right.
Okay. And so does the engineer department have anything to do with this process, Mr. Morris?
No, we try to coordinate our projects so that they can work together.
Okay.
You know, engineering is not on site and does not review the installation of the gas mains.
Okay.
So just, you know, good to see you again, Mr. Palmer. So I know that one of the things that we had talked about previously was having sort of like the projection, right? Either a 3 to 5 year projection of the streets that are coming up,
yes,
given your ballpark of 10 years. And you know, last year was a bit hectic around here. So I don't recall that we would be coming back again for the proposed streets that are being undertaken this time around. And then I guess, you know, for me and for the executive staff and department is, how are we overlaying, right? Because this is the conversation we've had previously. How are we overlaying our pavement plan with the streets that are coming in for Central Hudson, not just for 2019, but ideally 19, 20, and 21? I know that we're trying to do similar with overlaying around the lead service line replacement, right? So that if we're paving, we're not opening it up again, you know, a couple of months down the road. So that would be like the first thing. And then the other thing is, to the extent that we can have conversations about undergrounding utilities, and you've heard me say this before, at least to get a ballpark estimate of the cost. I know that it is higher. But again, you know, one of the things is we live in the historic district. Right now you've done a lot of work in the historical district, and underlining utilities in the historic district is sort of like one of the goals I think that as a city we've talked about wanting to do. So I'm just putting that up on the table again so that when conversations are taking place with department heads, you know, these questions get asked, a number gets attached to it, and then we come back to council to figure out how to make some of that possible. And are we going to get to which streets are part of this? Okay.
Yep. It was on there. I did.
I missed the streets. Maybe I'm just blocking it.
It's a list.
Yeah, so
yeah, it's attached. A list.
It's not in my drive.
I do, because I know that Councilman Sklar's had that same question about putting some of the wires underground. No, and so if you can surface that for us, that would be great.
Right. Okay.
If I could just
address the coordination with the city plan paving. We met earlier this month, and we were in possession of the 2019 City of Newburgh paving plan. And when we went back and looked in the areas where we do have leak-prone pipe, there's some of the streets are already plastic, and where no replacement's necessary, we don't plan on digging anything up there. So on the streets that do have leak-prone pipe, that is a candidate to be replaced. Currently, we're working quickly to design those projects, get in there, replace them, install a binder course, and then ahead of the planned paving that DPW is proposing.
Because, you know, Mr. Palmer, I really appreciate your patience and your due diligence in answering these tough questions. And I'm sure you can feel and read and understand the frustration that we have, and it's really not only from us personally, part of it is, but the other part is from our constituents who we represent, you know, call us. And I mean, we already get a lot of calls regarding, you know, our infrastructural work and the potholes and some of the things. So we've been working diligently. George has been working in his department and then putting out the bid roads and being consistent with getting these roads in shape, which have been neglected for decades. And then here we are trying to get these ADA compliant curbs, trying to get these roads paved so the quality of life can improve for our city and for everyone, even our visitors that come. And then we got Precision Pipeline in Central Hudson, tearing up the road for the entire spring and the entire summer.
Yeah.
And it's like, and then, you know, it's like, geez, you know. So my question, Jeremy, is with this presentation and in the final analysis, is this going to be a resolution up for vote, or we just, this is just for bubbles and giggles? What do we?
Well, it's, I mean, I don't know that I would call it bubbles and giggles.
I'm just joking.
There doesn't appear to be anything here that we've discussed that that appears to require city council, that appears to require city council.
So it's just an informative presentation?
Correct. If it turns out that there comes a time where city council action is needed, then that'll be brought to their attention.
Okay.
But based on the information today, it does not appear.
Okay. Thank you.
So, because I do have a standing question that Councilman Sklar had asked you earlier that I do want you to surface, but I did, Chief Horton, did you want to say something or no?
So the good news is we are going to look to hire a plumbing inspector next week. Completed the interviews Friday, and I have a candidate that I'd like to bring in front of the council as soon as possible. Keep in mind, though, with the street openings, the 400 connections that Central Hudson made in the 2017, that's 400 street openings over, say, a 6 or 8 month period. That's a full-time job to manage those street openings, and the plumbing inspectors is pulled between plumbing inspections on all the buildings, you know, that we're rehabbing throughout the city, all the work that he's doing with the complaints and the violations. So it's very difficult for one person to manage those 400 street openings on a regular basis. And that was all I wanted to say about that. It's a very large scale project. And when we're dealing with the capacity issues of staff, that one person, if he's off for 2 weeks, it's a struggle for us every day.
So Chief Horton, point well taken. I really appreciate that insight. But so my question to you is, and I go back to Mr. Morris and even Mr. Garrison, is there any way we can figure out support for the plumbing inspector? Because that is very overwhelming for one individual. And your point, like I said, is very well taken. Is there any way we can solicit support from the engineers department or from the DPW department that could help support this one individual who's going to, like you said, be overwhelmed with not only the street openings but also other matters regarding buildings and code? Is there any way we can get some sort of support?
Well, let me, if you guys want to speak to it, I mean, I know that,
you know, as far as that, I mean, I think we can have the discussion with Joe and Chief. You know, I don't have a problem with, you know, my water maintenance supervisor, who was the former plumbing inspector, came to me, and he would still like to keep his certification.
Yeah.
I didn't have a problem with that, so I'm going to speak to Joe about that
and
try to get that work. I don't have a problem with paying, you know, for that.
Okay.
I don't have a problem with working with Chief if he needs help to let my, you know, water maintenance supervisor to help out. I think we just have to have a discussion that. But, you know, and he is willing to do that. He has always stepped up to the plate and tried to help us out and help the city out, so I don't have a problem with that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Vandenberg.
George?
As far as street openings, what we could probably do is work with codes, have my labor supervisors work with a code enforcement officer, and designate one of my guys or one of his guys each day to do it so it doesn't back up anybody's work.
Okay. Right.
Excellent. Thank you.
That's good.
Thank you, sir.
So just looking at the list, right? So Montgomery, portions of Grand between, what is that, First, right? Liberty and Chambers. So part of the leveraging that we had talked about doing was Liberty, Grant, and Montgomery. So I just want to make sure that this is overlaid properly with the paving that we said we were going to do in 2019.
Yep.
So that's two affirmative yeses. Like
yes
for 2019. Yep.
Yes.
And we're not going to get into winter and okay.
As soon as they're done, we're going to be in.
And in our discussions, we'll be starting in those areas first and to move out so that the city can pave. The portion on Liberty Street, we've expanded the project slightly on Montgomery Street and to encompass all the areas that you're targeting for paving.
Right. So, you know, I mean, I just want to echo again the opportunity that we have, right, to leverage. And when we pull this off, it's actually going to be pretty amazing. So everybody will be happy for summertime. Yes, to the happiest place on earth. Okay, and then my other thing is, so it's also impacting the hospital area. So we've had conversations with the hospital.
Not up to this time, but that would be...
Yeah, Du Bois Street.
That's a good recommendation. We can definitely reach out to the hospital.
It's a conversation that we can have in the business development department. We can.
So there's an R person responsible, and so from your end, so Central Hudson is going to be the R in reaching out to through your governmental
critical facilities
liaison person. Okay.
If you'd like anybody else, I mean, hospital obviously, but just to bring it to our attention, and we wouldn't mind reaching out at all.
Yeah, I'm just looking at some of, you know, the stakeholders that are along this corridor, because you have a couple of CBOs also on First Street, and then RUPCO project as well, so.
That's a good thing to do.
And then the college would be the other one, City Orange.
They can't hear you.
The college and the church that's on that area. Okay. All
and
right,
now,
let's give it a whirl.
Yeah. So, really quickly, putting wires underground.
John, would you be able to speak to the wires underground?
Was that your board for presentation? What's that white thing? No?
I think the board is just a map that you guys have.
Oh, okay.
A larger version.
Hi, my name is John Masurgeon. I'm in our corporate communications department with Central Hudson. We can certainly speak to the city about putting wires underground. It's a project that those types of projects are usually paid for by the city. They're not socialized the way the gas replacement projects are often paid for. They require a high degree of coordination, not only with Central Hudson and the city, of course, but also the telephone company, Verizon, the cable companies as well. There are some things that need to be considered. For example, the transformers that are currently located on top of the poles now have to be placed on the ground, usually on private property. So there's a lot of work that has to be done with the individual property owners. And the connection between the underground lines and the homes and buildings are all done at the private property owner's expense as well. So it is a costly endeavor to put lines underground, but in some areas it may well be worth it. There could be federal grants that might be available to help pay for that, especially in certain historic districts. It's a long-term consideration. It's not something that we would be able to do in conjunction with these types of projects. This would be a separate undertaking. But the idea is to identify the areas that you'd like to see underground lines, preferably, again, historic districts, so that outside funding might become available to do that kind of work. And then we can discuss, you know, how we might be able to move forward. But again, it's a multi-utility city private property discussion that has to take place in order to do that kind of work.
Yeah, no, completely agree with that. And so I've been on this chair now for 4 years, going on my fifth year with 2.5 to go. And I've been bringing this up because by the time we end, you guys are going to be done with the historic district. And, you know, we've never had numbers and figures attached to it. So this goes to my point about having the 5-year plan of where you're planning to go, because it feels like you come on the yearly basis and say, these are the streets we're doing this year. We have the same answer, right? Because it was a similar answer that we got last year in 2017 as well. And so at what point do we get to projecting into the fifth year so that we can hopefully at least do, I would love to see at least one underground utility project. If we're looking at a corridor, I mean, we're going to miss the Liberty Street concept because this is going to get done. Maybe Grand would be one. If the rest of Grand is not scheduled, but again, you know, it's part of like not knowing what's for the next 3 years up the road so that we can then apply for those grants at the latest 2020, projecting out to 2025 or something. So I guess I just don't know if there's a five-year plan from you guys that can be shared with the city so that we can at least have those conversations.
I want to mention, too, that when we had the meeting, we also gave them our phase two of the ADA ramps that are going out. So we're trying to stay with them with this. So if we know what our phase three is going to be, maybe we can look into it where that's going to be to do that.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing we could share, we've done so in other municipalities, is to provide a street map with the areas that we already have plastic color-coded and the areas that are considered leak-prone. So then, if you have that information at your disposal, the paving plan is easier to assemble and further enhance our coordination.
Okay.
Thank you. See you next year.
Okay.
Thank you.
Regarding our communication and outreach, getting back to the presentation, this week we mailed out pre-construction letters for the customers and residents within the scope of our project. There's general construction information, and we have an open house scheduled at the Activity Center next Wednesday from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., which that information was in the letter. One thing that I'd like to bring before City Council is that historically we've seen that the attendance of those, even though they're mailed out to every customer, is low. So if there's any ideas where we could increase attendance to that and awareness of that open house, it would be much appreciated on our end. In addition to that outreach, this year we'll have a week ahead work schedule available on centralhudson.com, which I believe is going to be portaled into the city website. So if the residents go to the city website, they can get a direct link to our information, and that'll have which streets we're working on and the areas for the next week. So customers and residents will know exactly where we'll be.
If you get that information to us, we can certainly share it. For those of us who are on social media, we can share it there and other places.
Thanks. Thank you. Some specifics regarding our 2019 projects. We have one large plan project. It's what we call the Newburgh East project. It's 10,000 linear feet, and the bounds of the project are between Robinson Avenue and Montgomery Street, north of Broadway. And I believe you all have the map of the scope of the project. Along with the 10,000 linear feet of main, there's approximately 235 service lines that we'll also be replacing as part of the project. A large portion of the project's on First Street and also on Liberty Street, and then some peripheral streets and the way we design these is we would like to connect into existing plastic so we don't leave small sections of leak-prone pipe. So when we come into an area, we like it to be completely done so we don't have to come back and dig up that area. Some details on the construction. We're looking to get started here pretty shortly in early March, weather permitting. The duration, including the final paving, is 8 months. The actual gas construction will be shorter than that, but including our final paving with our designated restoration contractor, approximately 8 months. Precision Pipeline will return as our contractor to complete the work. In addition to the crews that are present, we have a full-time third-party QAQC inspector, and they're full-time at all times. So full-depth binder coarse asphalt will be installed daily as we move through the streets, and then that'll be followed by the aforementioned BTM, who is our restoration contractor. One point I'd just like to go back on the communication and outreach on the letters that provides a direct cell phone number of the project foreman. So if anybody has a concern, a problem, they have a direct pipeline to their cell phone and they can resolve the issue very quickly.
Right, because as I mentioned again before that, before this meeting, the quality of work is just going to be very, very important. Also, one of the issues that we had with other work that was done is we had people who were, I don't know what their title was, but they weren't the foreman. And then they were communicating to the community, and some of that information just wasn't, in my opinion, wasn't accurate. So I do like that you have someone's number where they can reach to directly.
Correct. And like I said, that's not a desk line. That's, they'll always have it on them. It's their cell phone, and they're able to resolve anything immediately. So that basically covers all of the details of what we have planned. If there's any additional questions that you may have, I'd be happy to answer them.
No, I mean, I think I'll do this again on Monday, but just for the folks who are listening tonight and may not listen on Monday, is to make sure that everyone takes pictures of the conditions of their property beforehand. You guys are also going to do it, right?
Yes, that's part of our pre-construction. Everything is photographed and videoed prior to construction.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you for your time. The next presentation we have this evening is from Victor Cornelius regarding Endeavor and municipal grant and loan financing.
Good evening. I want to begin by begging your indulgence a little bit. I'm going through some major dental implant surgery. I get up in the morning and I see my father at age 5, so I apologize for putting you through that experience. If you have any trouble understanding anything I have to say, just let me know and I'm happy to repeat it. I'm here as the owner of a firm that does grant writing and loan negotiation for a variety of municipal services. I have been doing this since 1991 when I began with the Village of Tivoli. I have successfully worked on the town of Greenville, the town of Hyde Park, the town of Rhinebeck, Village of Saugerties. In the last several years, I have raised $15 million in infrastructure money for the Village of Wappingers Falls. And my current largest client is the city of Poughkeepsie. And in the last 5 years, we've done $22 million in grants and subsidized loans for water and sewer projects and some road projects. I'm coming to you to initiate a discussion in three specific areas. The first two are water and sewer infrastructure. And those are specialties of mine, and I know very familiar with many of the issues you've had in this city. I will say that my best luck and the hardest work that I've been able to put in for my clients has been with cities and villages, denser, lower to moderate income populations. I mean, $15 million for Wappingers Falls, which is a mile square and 5,000 people's, quite a boost to their basic infrastructure reality. It solved a lot of issues. The third area that I work in is what I call sort of the general fund area, which consists of things that you support out of your general tax revenues, such as planning, parks, roads, various forms of basic support infrastructure for the municipality. And so I basically structure three separate contracts for that, the water contract, the sewer contract, and the general fundraising contract. The water, my water and sewer contracts are always covered back to the original payments, the initial payments by the Environmental Facilities Corporation. I'm like an engineering firm or a law firm. You get reimbursed for those too. And I know you have many critical issues to deal with. I operate in a kind of a facilitation mode. And Joe, I think, will back me up on this. What I basically do is I coordinate the local needs, the engineering firms, and I work very well with engineering firms, and I will add that a little caveat there by saying that I'm very good at taking what they want to achieve in a very specific design goal process and making it, putting the appropriate positioning on it so that it gets the highest possible points from the state and federal funding sources. Local government, the engineering firms, the municipalities, the state bureaucracies, and the public officials, and the federal bureaucracies, and the public officials. I do spend time both in Albany and Washington. I am your advocate. So you understand how I work. I do not contribute politically to anyone. And my only job is to get you the money that you say you need in a prioritized way that meets your requirements. Once you have the funding, I'm basically out of the project.
Right.
So that's sort of how we proceed. What I would do for you initially, given what I know of what you've been through and what you're experiencing and what you're up against, both in terms of your infrastructure issues, your community's needs, and also, you know, the litigation that you're engaging with or have engaged with, I would first sit down and analyze what grants you currently have and which of those grants are outstanding and what grants you may have gotten considerable periods of time ago but either have not accessed or have not completed, because it's nearly impossible for somebody to go back to a funding source if there's something hanging out there, right? So I know, for example, that you had a sizable federal appropriation some time ago. I'm not sure if those funds are still extant or if they've been repurposed, but I will find out. And I know that the reason that you didn't go to contract on those funds was the lack of the ability to provide the 20% match. I have a proposed resolution for that as well, which is not going to be uncomfortable for you. One of the things, there are several gray areas in all of this that I'm very familiar with. One of them is that when you have a project that is being funded through the State Environmental Facilities Corporation, the Clean Water State Revolving Fund and the Drinking Water State Revolving Fund, one of the things that they will do, if you put it in your engineering report, is that they will replace the roads, curbing, sidewalks, and pedestrian amenities in the area that you're working. In Wappingers Falls, in fact, when we were replacing the major sewer project down 9G through the main part of the village, because the preliminary engineering had been done in 2008, and by the time we got into the bidding in 2010 for the contracts, the bid came in at two-thirds of what we actually had told the state we needed in terms of the funding. So we went back to EFC and we said, kind of ingenuously, we said, we know you're going to replace the roads and the curving and the sidewalk, but we're going to have to send out people in detours around the village on roads that don't have sewer underneath them, and would you mind if we repaved those roads prior to ripping up the main drag so that we've got decent roads for the detour? And they agreed to it. So one of the things that I can do, and I've done it in many communities, is I can maximize what you're doing in terms of your vehicular and pedestrian infrastructure while you tackle a plan for replacement of lines or any kind of upgrades you're doing to the water engine, right? and get the cost of the roads out of your general fund, which is very straitened, I know. So that's one of the talents I have. I know where the gray areas are, and I know how to negotiate with the state. I know you have issues there. Part of my solution to those issues is to line up the grants and let the grants perhaps be the settlement that you're shooting for, right? Mm-hmm. Go ahead and pursue the funds and do it in a logical and well intellectually supported design way and well planned out.
So, Mr. Cornelius, we had the pleasure of meeting when I was an assistant grant writer for the district. It was about, I want to say 8 years ago or okay. something like mm-hmm. that. And you helped me with a shared services grant when we were digitizing some things for the district. So I do remember you from there.
Yep.
Your reputation, even at that time, had preceded you. But what I do remember is that you were a very small company as well.
I'm five now.
You're five now.
Yes,
there you go.
I've got a payroll.
So you've grown to five people.
Yeah, okay. And you know, it's also interesting. I've been through having a number of towns and sort of branched out in various areas. I do best with cities and villages. Mm-hmm. You know, these are the neglected areas of our economy, and these are the communities that benefit most from partnerships with the state and the federal government because of the density and the ease of replacement of the infrastructure. I mean, a dollar spent in Newburgh or Poughkeepsie goes far farther than a dollar spent in Carmel or, you know.
Right, right. Mr. Cornelius, first of all, I want to say thank you for coming tonight.
Sure.
Very impressed with your presentation thus far. I want to ask you, part of our revitalization efforts are not only dealing with roads, curbs, making sure that in ADA compliance, which is some of the most important infrastructural work. But one of the other elements is when we talk about the revitalization is making sure that our undeveloped land that we have throughout the city is what we call shovel ready. Mm-hmm. And so I know, you know, George has spoken to this. Mr. Morris in engineering department, Allie Church and I have talked about this on a number of occasions, and even our city manager. There's a lot of remediation that has to happen in a lot of our undeveloped land. We have the most undeveloped land on our waterfront in the entire Hudson Valley. Mm-hmm. We also have deep water ports in the Hudson Valley, which is good for tourism, and so we're looking to do some of that work. But what would you say in terms of how you would be able to assist us with trying to solicit funds, whether it be through grant or state or federal grant funding?
Do you have a local waterfront revitalization plan currently?
We do.
Does it reflect your vision as a board?
Yes.
Okay, good. That's the place where you start. I'll take a look at that, and out of that, the Department of State, New York State Department of State, has several grant programs. One of the things that we did was we put the village of Wappingers Falls into the Brownfields program at the Department of State. I'm not talking about what goes on at DEC.
Right.
This is the Department of State Brownfields program. And there was both, I think the grant was $390,000 simply for planning on how to tackle, you know, over there there's a Superfund site. There are lesser impact properties. We have to break it down into what the municipality owns and what the municipality may have access to and what is privately owned and what you can do to support a private developer. There may be state and federal tax credits that you can put on the table. Packages can be designed to help privately owned land.
Right.
And there are a variety of things that can be done. What you have to do as a board is decide what you want to see done.
Right.
You know, and if you've got an LWRP, let's start there. Let's sit down and pick it apart and see how we can fund certain aspects of it. I don't believe anybody went into last year's CFA for any LWRP money for any of the things that were in that program. And that's open to you now. Any of the projects that are in your local waterfront revitalization plan are fundable through the state. So we'll sit down. We can sit down with that plan, pick it apart, and get your priorities, what you want to see happen first.
Excellent. Thank you.
The other thing that I'm suggesting doing is...
One other quick thing. I'm sorry. One of the things, I received a call from Orange County about a year ago. In fact, we were up at the New York Conference of Mayors, and I got a call from Ms. Anderson, Nicole Anderson. She works under Steve Newhouse and the executive staff, and she was telling me about multi-millions of dollars in shared services that the county has. And one of the things I was trying to see happen, because it's an important quality of life thing for the city residents, with bulk garbage pickup. We lost that several years ago for budgetary reasons, you know, after the double dip recession in 2008. And I said, well, if the county could help us with some of those shared service funds to come and pick up bulk garbage in the city and other municipalities of Orange County, you know, that would be a great quality of life improvement for homeowners, residents, renters, whomever. And so if you could speak to any ideas you might have regarding shared service funds, sure, at Orange County and how to tap into those financial resources.
I'd find a model that works for you. Ulster County may have the model that you're looking for. And I can send you in that direction. The county takes a very proactive approach to regional waste management. I think the first thing for you to do, if you're going to do shared services, the best idea is to define what your geographic area, what makes sense in terms of a geographic area for waste management. And, you know, that's a discussion we can put out and take to the county. I have no problem doing that.
Okay. Thank you.
There are a lot of initiatives that we can tackle. One of the things I very much like to do, you have a lot of very interesting and disparate filings at EFC for water and sewer projects. Some of the filings are very old. Some of them are very recent. Most of them seem to be on the multi-year list, which is the back shelf. It means, no, they're not interested in doing anything this year. We have until May 1st to take a look at that, go through it, pare it out, figure out what your priorities are, change the preliminary engineering and reshape the current filings, reactivate some, eliminate some others that don't make sense anymore. Because it helps my process with ESC if you get rid of stuff that you've either done or are not going to do in the near future. And that's a specialty of mine. So.
Yeah.
Is there any planning you want to do, any comprehensive planning you want to do?
Well, right now we are finalizing our Vision 2020, which is a master plan. We had some, community engagement around the master plan for 2020. So that's something that's coming up very quickly, a 10-year plan for the city,
right,
which does include a revitalization. I think, Allie, if you want to speak to that briefly, if you can.
Yeah, so we've wrapped up the vision planning portion of the master plan, and we're looking to complete the comprehensive plan in the next year or two.
Right. Do you have funding for that?
No, we do not.
All right. Let's get this on the list.
Right. Thank you.
And so one final thing, because, again, you know, I had the pleasure of working with you many years ago. I think that it would be very important that if you do come to do some things for us, that you work very well with our departments, our planning and development department, our comptroller's department, of course, our city manager's department, and those things, just to make sure that we're doing a well-coordinated effort.
Okay.
I agree with you. I don't have a particular agenda or a formula for answers. What I like to do is to take the local need and to find the points in it. And I'm a good listener.
I know.
Great. Thank you, Victor. I appreciate your time.
Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity.
Moving forward from the engineering portion of this meeting, item number 5, Washington Lake Dam Spillway Reconstruction for CEQA.
This is a resolution declaring the Washington Lake Spillway Reconstruction Project a Type 2 action regarding and related to CEQR. That's the State Environmental Quality Review Act process. The Washington Lake Spillway is structurally deficient, and this reconstruction project will demolish the existing spillway and construct a new spillway to be in compliance with DEC dam safety requirements.
So really quickly, is this going to remove the dam?
No, this adjacent to the earthen embankment on Washington Lake, there's a concrete spillway. And the concrete spillway is roughly 300 feet long and involves roughly 3 foot high concrete walls and a concrete floor. So that was built sometime in the 20s, I believe. And it is past its useful service life and it needs to be completely replaced. So this is the design plans are done and we're in the permitting phase. In order to get the permits from the DEC and the Army Corps of Engineers, the City Council needs to declare it, the project, a Type 2 action for CEQR. So that's the purpose of this resolution.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions? Thank you, Jason.
Thank you.
The next item from finance, we have a proposal for services for O'Connor Davies, which Todd will speak further about. It's a resolution authorizing a city manager to execute a letter agreement between the city and O'Connor Davies for additional auditing services.
Hello. So this is a proposal to amend the original scope of services provided to us, the city of Newburgh, by our current auditors, O'Connor Davies, that were not previously included in the original contracts, but are necessary to complete some financial statements that we have outstanding. It's a favorable rate, and it was negotiated down as indicated in the engagement letter sent to the city manager.
Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you, Todd. Next, from our water department, we have a proposal for engineering services, which will be a resolution accepting the proposal and authorizing interim city manager to execute an addendum to the contract with Arcadis for professional services at the water plant.
So this is an amendment to the contract that we brought to you a couple meetings ago. Due to the fact that we are possibly could be switching our water sources to the Catskill Aqueduct, water source is obviously different chemistry than Browns Pond and Washington Lake, so we might have to make some amendments or adjustments to our corrosion control plan, which, you know, Arcadis would be doing that for us. We have the money in our budget.
Thank you, Wayne. Terrific.
Thanks, Wayne.
What's that?
What?
We're still on Browns Pond.
Shh, don't say that. Wayne, so we're still on Browns Pond. So we're doing pretty good with the water, right? Usage?
We're doing very good. We're down to 2.7 million gallons a day. The team fixed about 4 leaks this week. We've had some issues with some abandoned properties, which I have a plan that we'll tackle that once we get our new meters put in.
Leaks? Leaks at
Yeah, unfortunately we found a woman that became ill. She's in the hospital. She just got done renovating her whole home. She left the water on.
Oh, wow.
Her heat shut off and
wow.
Yikes.
Really damaged the house pretty good.
Wow.
But we did get it shut off, but we did about four this week. We had a main break today on Farrington Street, so we got that one tackled. That was about 24,000 gallons a day.
Wow.
So okay. We're doing good.
Great.
Browns Pond is still overflowing, so great. We're in really good shape.
So is there a reason why you possibly may switch back to the Catskills?
We're watching water quality and quantity.
So we don't need to do that at this point.
No, we're in really good shape. We're still overflowing, so it hasn't even got to the top yet.
Nice.
So
excellent.
All right. Okay. Great.
Thank you.
Wayne. Next, from Planning and Economic Development, we have an update from Allie and Chief Horton regarding code enforcement and distressed property.
All right.
Thank you.
This is what I was looking for.
Thanks.
So we wanted to do this presentation partly because we have another grant that later on the agenda you'll see we're asking, and they're starting to get confusing for us. So we figured that they may be confusing for you guys as well. So just a really quick background on what these grants are and how we got to this portion, to this point. So in 2012, a group of attorney generals sued the major banks over the mortgage foreclosure crisis. In New York State, they decided to invest the money in land banks and distressed communities through something called the New York State Housing Stabilization Fund, and there were additional settlements in 2016. So that's where we're at with that. At the same time, the city of Newburgh, as you all know, decided to update policies to address blight and disinvestment. This included creating the land bank, streamlining land use application process, and increasing code enforcement. So now going specifically, and I'm trying to go quickly because I know we're all tired, through these, the bank settlement monies, again, also known as the New York State Housing Stabilization Fund, these are specific grants to the city of Newburgh. I do have to add that, as I said, this fund also funds land banks. So our land bank is hugely funded. I'm not going to go over those grants specifically. These are just ones that Chief Horton and I have received. Or planning. So the first one is the one that we call the Zombies Grant. This was named originally the Zombie and Vacant Properties Grant Program. This was awarded in 2016. It was $150,000. It was $149,900 something. And this was where we hired a vacant and occupied property specialist. That's a code enforcement officer in the codes department, and it's currently Tammy Hollins. So that's how that position, if you know the work that she's been doing, that's how that originated. The idea of this grant was to make sure that we had a grasp on those who were potentially facing mortgage foreclosure or eviction, and so that's why we decided that position was critical.
How long does the grant go to?
So that grant funded the Tammy Hollins for 2 years, and now this year she's been placed under the general
fund. General budget now.
General budget now.
Yes.
Okay.
But still doing that same role.
She's doing the same role. She's managing the vacant property list, and she's also working as a resource for people who are struggling with, maybe they're being displaced because of condemnation, maybe they're having problems with their landlords. So she's a resource that the city provides to the tenants and to property owners to move the process forward through the codes, or if there's violations or moving people up to housing or emergency housing at 280 Broadway.
Right. Okay. Thank you. And so she has explained that to me on several occasions, and I noticed she's not here tonight, so perhaps at another time she can explain to the public exactly how she does, because sometimes I think there's a misunderstanding.
We'll be getting to our public outreach portion a little later in the presentation.
There you go. Yeah, that's right.
So the other series of grants are called Cities Rise. So as you see, we'll go back and forth between Zombies grants and Cities Rise grants. Again, all from the same pot of money. So Cities Rise stands for Cities for the Responsible Investment, Cities for Responsible Investment and Strategic Enforcement. The phase one grant of this was awarded to the city in 2017, and we were one of 18 communities in the state. what that gave us was not a monetary award, but a two-year license to a software program called Building Blocks, which I'll go over in a second, and also a development team to help us assemble all of the city's data into one software program. And a quote from the Attorney General at the time, "Cities Rise will deliver much-needed relief to communities still suffering from the fallout of the housing crisis." So just quickly, I know that the council has logins. Some of you have used them a lot and some are new to it. We are looking at twofold. One is getting more training for staff and council, and another is looking, we had a meeting this week on how to roll out Building Blocks with a public face so that the public will also have information. So generally what it looks like, it is this. Every single parcel in the city is mapped. And if you click on any one of them, you get some general information, but then we can really drill down into lots and lots and lots of data that's collected. Every department that is here is providing data into this website. So, you know, we have water department information. One of the things, for example, we discovered early on was one of the best tellers of how many people are living in a house or whether it is vacant is whether they're using water or not. So again, all of that data is compiled in here. It works very well on mobile devices, which was one of the issues we have for first responders and for code officers, is getting access to that data quickly in the field. And it also is extremely efficient at finding patterns in data, and one of the ones that we're just starting to drill down is owner data. As you probably know, a lot of our properties are owned by single owners own multiple properties. However, they may own them in LLCs or other things that aren't easily, we can't easily track who owns them. This finds patterns in their mailing addresses and allows you to permanently link properties to the property owner. So, you know, someone owns six or seven properties, we can link them, and it suggests that, you know, kind of like your phone when you have duplicate contacts, it says, do you want to link these? Yes, so we link them, and it allows us in emergency situations or just when we're doing analysis to figure out what else that landlord may own. And this week was one of those where we had an issue at a property and quickly could say, hey, this person owns all of these other properties and we right. need to address them as well quickly.
And what it also does, instead of always asking what's happening, it's starting to tell us why it's happening, why we're seeing a trend on a particular block where one building goes vacant and maybe code violations start to pick up. So we can literally hone in on one building that goes vacant and understand what's going on in the radius around it, rather than always just asking what's going on. Now we understand why it's going on.
Yeah, and there's some of the stuff we talked about in our executive session, but one of the things that's high on my radar, because the incident that happened this week regarding, you know, code violation in the fire department and so on, I got the calls and very unsafe, unsanitary, and circumstances. The council is in discussion with our legal department on how we can put teeth to the situation, where if there are landlords who are identifiable, whether they function under LLC, limit liability corporation, or as individuals, we want to figure out a way to bring forward a resolution to really hold, I don't like to use the word slum landlord, but landlords who are not meeting the code and have multiple properties, or even if it's one, and having people live in these conditions. So we got to put our heads together to really, really bring forward a resolution to have enforcement. And if there's a legal way, Chief, for us to figure out how to issue bench warrants, you know, for this particular matter, you know, we're trying to work through those legalities with our city manager and our corporate counsel as well.
Yeah, I can give you an example. I don't know if it's the same property, but we had one this week. Again, you know, it was a terrible condition, and the first question that was asked was, are there others like this? How do we do that? So quickly, we looked at that property owner. We saw a list of all the properties that that property owner owned and realized that none of them had a rental license recently, which meant that a code enforcement officer hadn't gone in recently. So a very easy first step is just to issue a violation for a rental license, which then gains us entry. And so we can do, you know, kind of small steps in a very proactive manner that way.
Question, how does that happen? I thought we were getting better with tracking a rental license.
Yeah. We are certainly getting better, but keep in mind there's 6,500 properties in the city with 11,000 housing units. There's two or three code officers working on these. We're not going to get to them on a regular basis anytime year after year after year. The onus is on the owners to call and set up the appointments for the rental inspections. Yes, we're doing much better. We were probably at near 0% 2 years ago, and we're much higher now, but we still have a long ways to go.
So let me ask you, Chief, really quickly, and I know I don't want to belabor the presentation, but so if someone doesn't file a rental license, what are some of those consequences once you issue a
violation? So they're issued a violation under, I think it's Section 230 in the code, that they have to apply for a rental registry inspection.
What's the fine?
230, Section 230 in the city code.
What's the cost fine?
It's anywhere. Typically, it depends on the nature of the violation that's within that portion of the code, but you're either looking at a potential violation of $250 per day for every day it's in violation, or $500 per day for every day it's in violation. Of course, a lot of the balance that you're talking about with each of the properties and every other one is that what you really want is compliance more than anything else. So to the extent that either through code enforcement or through the report of a violation up to the court, if a property owner or landlord comes in and responds in some fashion, they're given an opportunity to correct or to remediate the issues with respect to the rental license. There's certain baseline there's certain baselines that every property owner has to meet by way of safety, making sure that the windows are operable, carbon monoxide alarms installed, no leaky faucets, plumbing, working electric, heat, and so on. So if they sink money into making those repairs, that's really what the ideal goal is. Back to the point that Allie and Chief Horton were making, it's that the building blocks can kind of give you a quick and useful tool by seeing whether or not a property is a rental and seeing whether or not there is a rental license on file. Those are very quick, easy steps that we can take and the building department has been taking to try to see if a particular property is in compliance, and if they're not, to issue a violation, which starts trying to get somebody's attention if they were unaware that they even had to comply in the first place.
Yeah, so you're just trying to put some teeth in it, and even if it's an overwhelming, you know, a daunting task with 6,500 properties that have to be examined or whatever, if there's a consistent strategic methodology of getting, you know, let's say, I don't know, 50 a year.
Well, I would say it's more than 50 a year, and as we get further into the presentation, you'll see what our hope is to do is when we get to phase three.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I just want to say really quickly, you know, one of the things about building blocks is, like, I look at it as this is like our shot spotter, right, but for our buildings. So I just want to thank you guys and everybody who's, you know, worked on this since 2012, since before when all of this was just ideas, because to see how much we've been able to move in the amount of time with the limited resources, I mean, it's amazing. So I want to thank you guys for continuing to coordinate that aspect. Obviously, the, you know, Corporation Council's department, Jeremy at the helm of this particular, you know, the vacant and the disinvestment that has taken place in the city of Newburgh, the assessor's office as well, right, because this is a whole team effort that you guys are doing on this, DPW when they get called in, the water department, and then, you know, obviously planning and codes. I'm super excited about this, and it's one of those things, you know, when I think about legacy, right, of what I've attached myself and blood, sweat, and tears to, this is amazing.
A simple idea of how they described it is all the departments several years ago, were basically all working in silos. We were all just working in our little sphere of influence in what we were doing. Programs like Building Blocks and maybe one day Municity will connect the dots better for all of us, so that when Wayne takes care of a water leak, we already see what he's doing in Building Blocks, and we can figure out what our next step should be in code enforcement or in planning development or whatever the case is. Before, we never made those connections.
Yeah, and then I think we'll get to it, so I'll shut up. But for the public, right, this is one of the things that in all of the community conversations we've been talking about is for the public to be able to just stand in front of a building, input an address, and get the information that you're showing there, right? Things like, you know, who owns it, what are the violations that it has, I think that's going to be transformational.
So do I.
So this is the grant, Cities Rise Phase 2. Now we're moving into the Phase 2 of these grants. Cities Rise Phase 2 is one that we were just awarded. It was awarded at the end of 2018. This is $80,000. We've talked about this at length because one of the big portions of this is to hire a neighborhood stabilization coordinator. And that will be the person to really allow proactive rather than a reactive approach to distressed properties. So we hope to have someone doing that analysis and Building Blocks. We had a really short time with a wonderful intern, and the amount of data that she returned in like a month was overwhelming. Just someone who's allowed to specifically focus on that, looking for patterns.
Any idea when you'll bring that person on board?
So the job actually closes tomorrow. So then we'll look to hire as quickly as possible. And the other portion of that, that's $50,000. We've also received $30,000 for public outreach, specifically regarding equity in code enforcement. And so this is where we're really looking to have kind of a community conversation about how code enforcement can better. The big question that keeps being asked in our meetings is, why don't people interact with code enforcement? Why don't they call when they have violations? I'm sure you heard some details of some of the things that happened this week. How would people continue to live in that? Why wouldn't they call? And so those are really the conversations we're trying to have, and a little bit of a plan on some of the rollout of that.
Is that connected to FYI as well?
We're talking about that. So one of the things that they're doing is evaluating the ways that people interact with codes, including FYI. We had a meeting on Tuesday where we kind of gave them, you know, the consultants the FYI app, and they said, hey, we'll look at this. We'll see, you know, if we have feedback. One of the quick things that was pointed out was that FYI is not bilingual. And so, you know, we've already, if we look at the portions of the community that aren't interacting as much as we would hope they would, one of them is Spanish speaking. And so, simple solution, maybe we should have our app also available in Spanish.
Right, and we also talked about adding like the three major languages that we know of in the city, right? So it's English, Spanish, and Creole.
And to speak very frankly, we all know that we still have a serious housing crisis in the city when it comes to the quality of housing. So one of the unintended consequences of strong code enforcement is we are displacing people almost on a regular basis. We are moving people out of buildings that are unsafe. But the consequence of that is that we don't always have a place for them to go.
Right.
The Housing Emergency Center at 280 Broadway isn't always the answer. It isn't always the answer immediately, and it's also not the answer long term. And people are aware that if they do call code enforcement and they make that phone call and they invite the person into that apartment, that they might be asked to pack their belongings that day. And that's a very difficult position to put people in. And
yeah,
many times in their mind, they resolve it by saying it's better to have a roof over the kid's head tonight than to struggle to where I'm going to live tomorrow.
Right. And there's a challenge that we've again discussed recently, and it's something that we really want to look at, because we want to find the happy medium so that if code enforcement is taking place and citations or violations are being written and they have real consequences and real teeth, if you will, with those tickets, right? Then hopefully we can take those measures to get the landlords to remediate the properties so that the people aren't displaced and people, those vacant or those buildings aren't shut down or considered condemned.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So And that's why, that's another reason why we really got to look at the legal aspect of how we can put some serious teeth to the code enforcement when we give citations.
And catch things early. So one of the ideas we have is that a series of meetings with Chief Horton, with Tammy Hollins, and with Felix Medina, to kind of meet a code officer. If you feel comfortable talking to someone early, we can solve, we can have, you know, problem solved before it comes to the level of condemnation. And that's, it's not a goal for anyone to have to condemn a housing unit. It's terrible.
So it would essentially be an open house, maybe in each ward, that meet your code officer, ask some questions, and the next time you need to call us, you maybe you won't, you know, have that, be discouraged to do so because you've already met us.
Right. Also, when we talk about people being displaced because of code violations and unlivable conditions, we have a serious homelessness population, and part of that is, and Joe and I have talked about that, and some of our council members as well, we just came to the resolution that the city of Newburgh and the city of Middletown are the only places that I know in Orange County that have homeless shelters. So when you go to New Windsor or you go to, you know, the town of Newburgh, or you go to, I don't know, Montgomery, Pine Bush, they, and I want to say intentionally, I may be wrong by saying that, but they don't have homeless shelters. So what ends up happening is when the county has people who are without a home, they either come to the city of Newburgh or go to Middletown. And I get a lot of those phone calls. You know, especially during the winter months. So that's something else we got to look at, as that aspect is how these shared services, including homeless shelters, can kind of be spread out in Orange County.
So quickly, two more grants, but these are the two that are that we have not received yet. So we're asking for your support on a resolution tonight to apply for and accept Zombies 2.0. We've been asked to apply for $200,000 for this this portion of the Zombies grant. Our plan is to use what would amount to about $150,000 of that. Remember, the previous position, we only have 8 months, so we'll use this to fund an additional 2 years so we can really have that person be in the position. In addition to that, more and specific training for the current code compliance staff. And then the final point is something that we did 2 or 3 years ago, which is to have in the city of Newburgh, have the state come in to do a New York State Building Safety Inspector training here. And that's the first level of training that you need to be a code officer. The idea is that community members can take that as they did last time. City staff can take that if they're interested in having more training. But also we hope to spur a new generation of code officers.
Circling back to, we talked about working at NFA with the high school seniors, this could be an excellent opportunity for students to start taking classes in code enforcement, and maybe as they graduate high school, they're looking at a position in the city of Newburgh as we cultivate our own code officers, because we typically will find it difficult to hire code officers.
Right.
So if we're working with the seniors out of NFA, and maybe build a pipeline of students to code officers here for the city of Newburgh.
Mm-hmm. And I know really quickly, and Grice and I work closely with, well, I work in the PTEC program, mm-hmm. NFA North. That's part of technology, especially when you start talking about leveraging and streamlining, you know, this process with software and data and stuff like that. So the PTEC program wouldn't be a bad connection.
Yeah, absolutely.
He and I can make that happen.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to say that this is such a great concept, right? And we know we can get the individuals, because once upon a time we had gotten a cadre of folks to go out and do just assessment, visual assessments from the outside. And then the last time we did it, you know, it was only a handful of folks from the community who were able to take the code enforcement training. And I was one of them. It's a long process and it's grueling, so it's definitely demanding, but it's so worth it. So. And I'll add that one of the people is currently employed in the codes department.
Correct.
And she received that job partly because she had a bump up because she already had the training. So that was Tammy.
So Tammy and I were the civilians who were participating in the, yeah. So I have my certification.
So finally, my final slide is the big money, and this is what we're working towards. So Cities Rise Phase 2 sets us up, pre-qualifies us for anywhere from $500,000 to $1 million to actually implement the plan that we're working out. And this is what we've all, many of you have been working with us on this, what we're really looking towards. So what can code enforcement look like if given a very healthy budget for 2 or 3 years? What can we do? What kind of software? What kind of innovative solutions? What kind of staffing levels can we get? And so that's where.
So instead of finding out about somebody living in a very poor building, we're going out there and being proactive and really hammering down on the rental registry, and just instead of finding problems at 2 o'clock in the morning, we're taking care of them at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Nice. Right. Also, I know, Allie, some of us are going to Harvard. Yep. In May,
yep.
As a part of RISE Phase 2.
Yep.
Do you want to speak to that?
Sure, yeah. So as part of RISE Phase 2, with the capacity building, there is an executive retreat. Myself, Chief Horton, the mayor and the manager, and Councilwoman Mejia will be going to do leadership training. A big model in all of these programs, and one that we're also taking on with our community outreach, is something called Train the Leaders. So the idea is that you take people who are natural leaders in their community or assigned leaders, obviously the mayor and the manager are assigned leaders, and you give them a certain level of training and they bring it down to their coworkers and their community members. Again, that's also something that we're looking at with community outreach. So if we have faith leaders and other just natural community leaders, they create a sense of familiarity and comfort with the codes department.
Right. So I'm not sure if I've ever said it publicly, so I do want to say it publicly. Now I want to thank our Planning and Development Department for all of the work that you're doing. I especially want to thank Chief Horton. Every time when I get one of those phone calls or email or something, I usually get a sliver of what the situation is. But then when I send it to Chief Horton to ask about it, he usually gives me a very detailed report, and it's really the full story. So I want to thank you for that, and I want to thank you for all the hard work that you're doing. I truly do appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you both.
Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Thank you both. So the next item, we have a purchase of 144 Johnson Street.
So 144 Johnson Street is a very small, very dilapidated property. Lauren Smith, who is joining us tonight, has a proposal in front of you. He has done other properties in the city, including one that's asking for that you have the release of restricted covenants coming up tonight. He's successfully done them. One of the things I think that the city, Lawrence is a city resident, I should add, and one of the things that the city, going back to our previous presentation, is excited about. Chief Horton and I had the opportunity to walk through this building. He's actually turning it from a single family now and adding what we're calling a micro unit in the basement. As we start to look at things like homelessness and displacement, having these much smaller, much more affordable units as accessory units in buildings is something that we're really trying to have wonderful developers like Mr. Smith help us with. So we're excited for that.
The micro unit have been reading lately about it, that other states and municipalities are trying it out and working on codes. I think it was Seattle or Portland. It would be great to kind of, take pictures, and if you don't mind, and kind of market that yeah. That's something that, someone who's coming into the city who's purchasing a property, that's an option. Mm-hmm. Right? And it's doable because you obviously did it.
Yes.
Yeah, that would be great if we could kind of use that.
And I really appreciate it. And David Cole, I have to say that he's very thorough.
I mean, he calls me up all the time, and he's on me. You know what I mean? He don't let nothing slip past. He said, "What is this?" Like, man, that's how he talks to me. But he's very helpful. I mean,
great.
And I really appreciate it. You know what I mean? And it's real hard work, you know, but I get it done. You know, I did 159 North Miller Street back in 2005. The building was, oh, man, they shouldn't even sold it. But I made it through it, you know. And I also have to thank W.H. Day. WHJ, Heat and Plumbing, Wayno, and also Bob Fetzer. They're excellent, you know what I mean? Electrician, excellent plumber. Anytime I call them, because you know, they're always busy, they get right to me, you know what I mean? So right. If you guys are talking about code violations and stuff like that, I have to mention their name a lot. I've been dealing with them since 2005. Very friendly guys, their prices is good, and they fair, you know what I mean? And, they're good people, you know, and that's what good. We need around us, all of us, to get the city back together. There's a lot of other things I could do with my money, but, you know, I ride around and I see some of the buildings, like this building, have a lot of garbage in the back of it and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I see how they're trying to fix this other green building next to it. So I said to myself, it'll give me something to do. And I also bring other people here with me, too, as you know, each time I come. And I bring people that do have the financial resources and the knowledge to be able, if they decide to purchase a building, they would do so.
Wow. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, and Ms. Smith, if you have a card before you leave us a card.
Do I have a card?
A business card?
Me? No, I don't have none with me.
All right, okay.
we can supply.
Yeah, we'll get it from you.
I can get his contact information.
His contact information. Yep. Okay. Good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Smith.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Next item on the agenda is 104-106 William Street, satisfactions of mortgage.
So 104-106 William Street, satisfactions of mortgage are just some old housekeeping items. The city of Newburgh issued two mortgages back in 1986. These were of the variety that were the kind of forgivable loan if the mortgagee complied with certain requirements, most notably if they held onto the property for a certain period of time. In both instances here, it would be 5 years. What has happened over the period of time is that the original mortgagee never received a satisfaction of mortgage. He has subsequently conveyed the property to another, who then conveyed it to another, and then that person is now looking to sell it. And these old mortgages came up. It appears from the records that we have in the city that the original owner complied, meaning that they held on to the.
I'm listening. I was just distracted. Okay, I'm sorry.
That the original owner held onto the property for the requisite period of time to basically convert it into a forgivable grant. So now we're just complying with the owner's request, or the current owner's request, to release those mortgages.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you. Next item, number 11, release of covenants at 15 Liberty Street. It's a resolution authorizing the execution of the release of the restrictive covenants and write a reentry from a deed issued to the owner.
So you have in your packets the information, the request from the owner, John Bonham. Chief Horton went in and conducted an inspection of the property on April 5th, saw that there were no open code violations of record, no open permits, no other issues. Property would have met and did get a C of O.
Nope.
Another release, 35 Concord Street.
So this is Lawrence Smith, who you just saw a little bit earlier about the purchase. This is his request related to property at 35 Concord that he went and rehabilitated as well. Again, Chief Horton went into the property, conducted his inspection on February 9th. No open code violations of record, no other violations on the property, no open permits, everything's closed out, valid C of O.
Next item, number 13, stop the DWI program, which will commence March of this year. And the chief will talk further. It's in agreement with the county.
Yeah, this is grant money to conduct DWI enforcement in the form of traffic safety patrols. It's money we get every year. Not a lot, but you know, it augments our shift strength and helps us with DWI and traffic enforcement.
Great stuff.
Next item, New York Industries for the Disabled, who supply custodial services for the city. It's a resolution authorizing interim manager to execute a contract with New York State Industries for the Disabled Incorporated to provide custodial services to city-owned buildings located at 55 Broadway and 123 Grand for the period of September 1st through August 31st of 2019 for the cost listed.
So this is for cleaning services. The city has been involved in this contract since 2014 for cleaning services. By everybody's account, the cleaning services are provided through the contract are great, and I don't know anybody else who has a bad word to say about them. But you'll see a small increase in the cost, which is just linked to prevailing wage, and that's it. Other than that, everything else is status quo.
Yeah, we used to do it in house. But it cost us more to do it in-house than it does to do it this way.
Okay. And I'm guessing that this organization hires individuals with disabilities.
Yes.
Which correct. Is something right in line with.
By law, you have to go to them first for this.
So that's awesome. Yeah.
Item number 15, apply for and accept if awarded Zombies 2.0 grant from LISC, which Ali
again, this was talked about before. This is the $200,000 to retain the neighborhood stabilization coordinator to add additional training for current code staff and to allow for the community code officer training.
How long does the community code officer training, what's the time frame on that?
So when will it be offered, or how long do you have to sit there for?
Both.
So we haven't scheduled it. We haven't received this award yet, so we haven't scheduled it yet. I think it's three classes, 3 days, is it?
There's two layers of code officer training. The first class is about the first three classes total, 9 to 10 days, and then the second three classes
total,
9 to 10 days.
So overall, over 120 hours of training. Okay, thank you.
That's open to council, right? The training?
Yeah. Yes, Councilwoman Mejia went the last time. Yeah. Yeah.
All of us are going to take it.
That'd be terrific. I'll take it with you. Item number 16 is an agreement with BOCES for some archival storage services that they will be supplying.
This is just an update. This is something that we had planned to do annually. It was budgeted for 2019. We just have not renewed the contract. This is in the quest to move the records to safe locations and move them off the third floor of 123 Grand Street. Our important archival documents, our original deeds to the city, things like that, are now stored in a proper, secure location at BOCES. So BOCES built four municipalities a storage facility. This is our rental fee. Again, it was budgeted. It just we didn't approve the contract.
When
do you want an update?
With the BOCES, no. Oh, okay. With the BOCES, I applied for a grant some time ago for the school district where we digitized our human resources records.
Yeah.
Is it possible to work with them on digitizing some of our things?
Absolutely. So we have another open contract with BOCES where they're helping us basically move the records from the third floor. Part of that help is, again, what we can purge. Another help is what we can digitize. And the rest is just how we should move the ones that we can't. So we are planning for that. I will say that it is an additional cost to digitize records. That's actually something we've talked about specifically for the codes records with that $500,000 to $1 million grant is what things can we digitize so we can have them in building blocks so we can use them every day. So it's a twofold. We have access to them better, and also we don't have to keep the paper copies. So, yeah, we're thinking of that, and BOCES is helping us.
Yes.
I think that's their Office of Records Management, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you, Ali. Last item, number 17, license agreement with Mountain Valley Guides regarding executing an agreement with them for access to use of the Washington Street boat launch in Unico Park.
So I was going to present this as this being the third year. This will be the fourth year, though. So Mountain Valley Guides, for the last 3 years, this being the fourth, has provided kayak tours from our waterfront. It's fantastic service. It allows different people to be able to access the river in a different way. If you don't own a kayak, I certainly recommend taking one of these tours.
And the progress on the South Street Park?
So we were not awarded the grant that we went after for South Street Park. We're looking at other options of having that being built with some other existing funds that we have some rearranging. Jason and I are working on some magical money rearranging. So we don't have a definitive date, but it's up there.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Resolutions of support, we're going to be appointing two members of the Human Rights Commission. That information is in folders. And lastly, under old business, we have Dance Camber Fracked Gas Plant Expansion Issue.
Okay, so on Dance Camber, there was talk about trying to become eligible for what's called intervener funding in Dance Camber's current proposal to expand energy services up at its plant in the town of Newburgh, and trying to work through the maze of laws to determine whether the city of Newburgh could be eligible for intervener funding, and if so, under what circumstances. So it turns out that with the help of Ali and some quick GIS work, there is a path by which the city can become eligible for intervener funding in terms of the development process. So I do want to step back and just say that, first of all, there is a online through the New York State website, there is a way for council members, for any member of the public, to go online and take a look and see who parties are, who are interested in the project, documents that have been filed in either in support or against, or people who just have general questions about the nature of the project. And there's already been a number of documents that have been filed. You can find that on the New York State Public Service Public Services website. And if you have any questions about that, you can certainly feel free to contact me, and I'll point you in that direction about where to find some of those documents. Now, the intervener funding eligibility has certain deadlines by which you have to meet. You should know that that Dance Camber, the application was filed on February 8th of this year. To become a party, you have to file in addition to the municipality being within a certain radius of the project, has to file a notice of intent to become a party. So that's something that we can work on preparing if the council's interested in doing that. And that ultimately is what creates the path to potentially getting intervener funding. In the way that the funding works is the monies can be used to defray costs for legal consulting witness or certain administrative costs for what they call the scoping phase of the proceeding. What I gather that basically means is the applicant puts forward a proposal, and then as a municipality, citizens, whoever, there's going to be questions that come off of that proposal. How do they where are they citing certain things? How are they they might be more engineering service related things, almost kind of like in a planning board type type setting. How do they expect to achieve what they want to achieve by the kind of the placement and development of the plant? The monies are used to analyze, or can be used to analyze the existing plan, and to potentially and to potentially be used to add more detail or offer certain analyses or critiques of whatever the existing plan is. It's not necessarily a dollar for dollar match. What basically happens is the process calls for the applicant to put a certain amount of money into a pot for which there is what's called intervener funding. That pot right now is $200,000. By law, there is a kind of a point person who is designated. He's the presiding officer of the overall project. That person's charged with delegating out those monies in an equitable fashion, meaning depending on the number of participants in the depending on the number of participants and the kinds of questions that they're asking, he or she can dole out the funding accordingly. 50% of that pool, so $100,000, is mandated to go to municipalities who are registered parties for the project. But what those municipalities have to do is show that they've done some advanced legwork in analyzing the project, or maybe engaging either legal services or engineering services or someone to analyze what's already been there, and then those entities can provide their further comment or recommendations on the project as it's been submitted. And then what happens is the presiding officer of the overall project can, in their determination, either fund what the cost of those services would be, or potentially reimburse the municipality for laying out those costs.
Okay.
So that's general gist. And all of that has to happen in a pretty quick time frame.
That's what I was gonna ask you. I was gonna ask you about the time frame.
Yeah.
Because some of that seems to be happening, you know, pretty quickly. And then about the cost, but the statement that I really wanna make is that I'm a proponent for renewable energy. So I was ready to bring this resolution. I was ready to vote yes for it from the very beginning. I'm a proponent of renewable energy. So we could do an intervener and whatever other ener. And I'm still right there.
So, I mean, just for the record, we're not a registered party.
Not at the moment.
But there's no way we could be a registered party, though, correct?
No, there is. There is a path. At one, there was a question. There was a question about whether the city could become a party and under what circumstances it could become one. Mm-hmm. There is a path. It's a two-part path. One is you have to be within a certain distance of the site. The city of Newburgh is within that radius. It's a 5-mile radius, kind of as the crow flies. And then the second step of it is filing a document that would express a notice to the parties involved in that, that the city wants to become basically a registered party in that process.
And what are the pros and cons of that? What's the purpose of that?
It could allow that municipality to have some more registered input on the process if it elected and wants to have the input. You're not making a determination. What it's not is making a determination to say what you're for or against the project, right? What you're doing is It's allowing the municipality the opportunity to more critically evaluate the project as it's submitted with the assistance of professional review staff or developers and say, look, here's this project. If we were injecting ourselves into this, these would be the technical questions that we would have about the project. How do you propose to, what's your design structure, basically? A lot of kind of, a lot of engineering and design phase questions. Also, how they might look to use and transport fuel service or electric services, how they might have to discharge certain materials with respect to the environment, how they care for those. So it's what the municipality can then do is hire, as an intervener, is potentially be eligible for funding to assist them in getting technical expertise to better evaluate the propriety of the submitted plan.
So the purpose of the intervener funding is to better fund and support financially who, which entity or what party?
It's designed to assist interested parties, including eligible municipalities, in explaining, analyzing, and offering a critique of the existing plan. Okay. So that way they can break down and say, look, they might say, look, from a layman's perspective, we don't understand exactly what this whole layout looks like. I don't understand it from my perch at in the Corporation Council's office, because you need a lot of technical expertise to do it. But a municipality could hire a firm or a company that does have that technical expertise in a way that would open the door to letting them analyze this project.
Make an informed decision.
Or at least give input into the process and say, look, we, based on the current plan, you require more of this resource or less of this resource, or you may want to consider citing something here as opposed to there.
So that means that if you apply for the intervener funding, and you get the intervener funding, then you can hire experts on this particular issue or this plant and what they're doing, and then the second step is to become a registered municipality so you could be a part of the Article 10 process?
It's almost in reverse, where you would register to become part of that process,
so we
offer,
can give
offer,
input.
Offer comments and critique, right, and then you're giving input. It's almost, right. The closest analog that I can give here is if you've been a part of the local planning board process. An applicant is going to come in and want to do something with respect to their property. There's going to be a board that reviews that, and then there could be interested parties that offer comment about some of the technical details of somebody's particular project.
But we, I might have missed that part. We would have to expend some of those funds first?
Possibly. So that I, as I sit here, I can't tell you the exact mechanic of how that's going to work. I just haven't gotten that far into it. What the law tells you you can do is it says that you can apply for services. You can apply for services that you feel are worthy, and there's a whole application process. Now, it seems to me that the application almost calls for some kind of advanced knowledge about the kinds of details that you're going to request to be analyzed. So how that works, whether the city would have to outlay funds and then apply for reimbursement of those funds, or whether it would have to solicit a private firm to get them on board to provide those services, and right. Then the municipality would report that to the presiding officer of the project and say, look, we have an engineering firm on board or a law firm or environmental law firm on board who can appropriately analyze that, and we are asking the presiding officer to grant the municipality X number of dollars because that's what they've quoted, that's what they've quoted us to analyze the pros and cons.
So for me, it really just comes down to one question, and I'm only speaking for myself, and so I don't need an intervener fund for that. Is it renewable energy? If it's not, then, that's where I am on that. I think he had to step out.
Okay, because I had a question for him. So, because one of the things that when we had, at least at the meeting that I participated in, when the representatives from Dan's Camera were here, one of the things that, you know, I requested was just some of their historical numbers, right? Because, you know, they proposed that this is going to have job impacts for City of Newburgh residents. And I don't know if they were able to get that data either to the mayor's office or to the city manager's office. And with, you know, with which, I guess, how serious are they?
Well, I think they reached out to all of us individually. Right. So they were willing to sit down and talk to us because they knew we had questions.
So.
What was that?
No, they had reached out and given numbers historically of who they've hired, how many City of Newburgh residents they've had in the past, and, you know, how are they coming to the table with some language that would then guaranteed.
Yeah, we're still waiting on that data.
Correct. I've spoken with them. That information has not been supplied to me, though.
Yeah, I haven't received any. I talked to the union president, Local 17, and I've gotten some information regarding ideals for employment for city residents, and I've gotten ideals about the apprenticeship and how to figure out transportation for City of Newburgh residents who may potentially be hired with Local 17. Mm-hmm. So Todd DiOrio and I've had several conversations since their presentation here, but I haven't spoken about or heard from Dan's Camera regarding the data that we've requested, so we're still waiting on that data analysis.
So just so I can get one idea about whether or not the council wants to proceed, just again on the intervener funding element of it, we would have to file a notice of intent to become a party, which doesn't appear to be all that complicated, but I'm sure as I say that I will.
What's the deadline?
Crow. It's March 25th because that's 45 days from the filing of the application for our notice of intent. Interestingly and oddly enough, the funding conference and the preliminary funding application has to be submitted by March 15th. I don't understand how that interplay works. If you can, how you basically have to become a party prior to the 15th and then show that. And then decide. So if the council wants, we can certainly file that notice of intent. I mean, that work would presumably be looked at with an eye towards either becoming a participating party or looking for or actually forming an application for actual intervener funding. You don't have to make that decision now, but the notice of intent, we should have some idea of it for the first March council cycle.
But I mean, I think my opinion, and it's just my opinion, we should be filing that we want to be an interested party so that we can also go for the intervener funds. Because, I mean, it's being able to have some funds so that we can articulate with some data as to the impact of their expansion in our city, which right now we don't have.
And with that being said, I think we need to, I'm going to have a conversation with our city manager and get his insight, because he and I have been working offline with this probably more frequently than the other council members, and we have to really decide with a cost cost analysis of what not only the financial costs may be to the city, but also what other intangible costs may be rendered for with the city in terms of potential employment and other things too, the economic elements of it. So I definitely see the value in the intervener funding. I see the value in, you know, being a registered party. I see the value in putting ourselves in a position to get as much information and have input on this. I definitely agree with that. It's just that I just really want to make sure we cross all our T's and dot all of our I's and make sure that we do a full, thorough cost analysis of getting in. And I mentioned this at previous council meeting. Here we are interjecting ourselves into a dogfight that had nothing to do with us per se directly, knowing that, yeah, we share the airspace and, yeah, we all want renewable energy, and we know that there's a national movement on that, and that is part of our master plan, our, you know, comprehensive revitalization plan to be a renewable city. But we got to really look at the hard numbers and see where we are and where we want to be in the next 20 to 50 years, because that's even on the national agenda with our Congress. You know, the new Green Deal. Yeah, the new Green Deal. So we really just want to make sure we're making an informed decision about that and interjecting ourselves as a municipality and doing a thorough cost analysis on that before that decision.
I think I would agree with everything the mayor has said, except with the that we're interjecting ourselves. So I think that that's where I'm going to, you know, just disagree on that, because we're not interjecting ourselves. This is just doing our due diligence to make sure that we're watching out what our neighbors are doing. And I think that an expansion of that size, the impact in our community, it's not interjection. It's just good business.
Okay, we play semantics then. Once again, that's something that they weren't asking for from our municipality. I am happy that we are taking an approach to be informed about what is going on, because environmentally it does involve our airspace and our shared airspace and our natural habitats. But at the same time, you know, again, Joe and I will have a conversation and a meeting, and we'll consult with the city council members, because again, we want to look at a thorough cost analysis, because there may be costs associated with one, becoming a registered municipality, and two, applying for the intervener funding, and you know, non-tangible costs. Joe, you want to add to that?
I'd be happy to talk further about that. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so we're leaving it as that the mayor's office and the city manager's office are taking the lead in having conversations to get us to whatever the next level is by before these deadlines, right? Because we do have to make a decision by March 1st about which avenue for intervener funds and for filing as potential interested parties. Am I correct on that? Am I understanding that properly?
To become a party for the long term phase of the program, you have to file the notice by March 25th. To be part of the preliminary funding conference for intervener funding, that funding conference is March 15th. It's weird. It seems that it should be opposite. But the point of it is that if to file that notice of intent and to have all that ready, it should be ready for the next city council.
So
that's really what you were.
Right. So then I'm accurate in my assessment that you guys will lead the next steps to that, so that we can make a decision.
Yeah, we're gonna loop you in it.
Don't loop me in it.
I would say,
Joe, we're gonna loop her in.
Be happy to include any interested party in those conversations.
I am not interested. My mind is pretty much made up.
Adjourned.